Jacksonville Gorge for several days looking for people who had family. During this time, I met a very kind author by the name of Tense Franklin Banks, who I'll talk about more at the end, who invited me into her home and allowed me to comb through her records that her and her mother had taken for decades, and had everything from rare photographs of the lights, to eyewitness accounts, to local folklore. She wrote a book regarding the area that will be linked in the description, and this video would not have been possible without her. Also, several of the photographs I'm going to use from this video come from the Ark Adventures on YouTube, who has the best photos ever of the Brown Mountain Lights, and a man named Burgess Bell, whose favorite pastime is going up to Wiseman's View and taking pictures of the lights. While I was there getting footage for my video, I met him, and he was very kind, taught me how to use my camera, and even offered me access to several of his pictures and videos, and I greatly appreciate it, and he'll be linked in the description as well. Several of the stories you're about to hear have never existed in the public record until now, so hopefully you're at least half as excited to hear it as I am to tell it. So today, for the Halloween season, we're going to talk about one of nature's most haunted mysteries, the Brown Mountain Lights. Hopefully I won't fall off the cliff, although that will get a lot of views. And as an important announcement before we get started, ladies and gentlemen, I present you Wendigoon U2's doll is available to purchase at the link in the description. U2's allowed me to design this pagan idol, vinyl figure. I gotta stop doing that. And I couldn't be happier with how it turned out. Look how well they did on, the hair and the antlers. Isn't he just the cutest? They even let me design the box, which has an entrance to Hollow Earth and a spooky forest wrapped around it, along with several of my stupid quotes that I'm honestly surprised they let me get away with. And every time one of these little guys is sold, it supports me directly. So if you decide to pick one up, that really means the world, and I greatly appreciate it. I know that it will go directly towards funding more of these self-destructive ventures that I call YouTube videos. So again, live now at the link in the description at youtubes.com. He'll be here for a very short time, and then he's gone forever. I should also mention that I am not responsible for any chanting or whispering that you hear while in his presence. But don't let that scare you off. Feel free to put him anywhere in the house, and there's never a reason to hide from him. He already knows your sins. Again, thank you all so much for supporting me. It really does mean the most. Hope you check him out. Link is in the description, and we are back to the video. We are going to go ahead and get into it, but as always, thank you for watching. Now, there's lots of cover with the Brown Mountain Lights, so it's probably the best that I've done. And the first official mention of the lights specifically comes from a 1912 article. So in that article, it says that the locals have together seen the lights in the village. Now, this wasn't the first written mention of the lights, we'll get to that later. However, it was the first published mention. With this announcement, the lights became a local legend. Directly, there's really no mistaking it. These giant floating orbs of what appears to be fire or lightning that hover in and above the tree line. It became a national spectacle, and so much of a spectacle, in fact, that the government got involved. In 1913, the United States Geological Survey, or the USGS, sent an agent named D.B. Sterrett to come investigate its claims of the Brown Mountain Lights. D.B. Sterrett walked to the top of Wiseman's View.
That Wendigoon? Yes, it is. I am not feeling well today, so it's just going to be chill stream. And it probably won't last long either. But hello, Jay. Hey, Mon, how are you? You're fucking... Oh my god. Your new model looks so fucking pretty, by the way. It looks so nice. 10 out of 10.
So, in 1922, drug-filled state at the Lovins Hotel for 2 weeks, and while he was there, used all
the time. And he's like, yeah, it looks so nice. Halloween being so far, it is nearly 3 o'clock. I woke up so late today, and I had to take my meds late, and that's kind of fucked me over. But now I'm just tired. Hearing your background music is so nostalgic. Oh. Thank you. Yeah, we just haven't seen each other in a while, I think. Yeah, but I woke up at like 12 o'clock and I had to take. I had to take my blue tablets today, and they just make me tired as piss, so. Low energy stream. Well, I'm gonna at least try and finish my last two commissions I have. Hopefully. I'm gonna try and not do too much today because I have my therapy. My fucking therapy session tomorrow, and that's gonna make me even more tired. How did Debug go on? Feeling too well, to be honest. Just very tired at the moment. So it's probably going to be a short kind of stream. I want to try and finish these commissions though, so. Yeah.
It's Several sightings that occurred during a trip in 1908, before Jules Verne's novel, before the electrification, or the stories of the lights become popular. And also, I don't think I have to tell you this, but that's not how electricity works. If that was how it works, every field or forest in the country would be full of these giant lightning bolts every night, but they're not, for some reason. So if that theory can be debunked, then what are some of the other theories people have come up with for what the lights could be? Well, one of the most popular theories up until recent years was that of the will of wisps, also known as gas lights. Gas lights are a natural phenomenon that occurs whenever gas dissolves inside of a smoky area and rise up into the air before igniting. They're quite rare, but again, common in smoky environments. However, thorough studies of the gorge, the minerals, the river, and the ground around it
Thank you so much for the ride. Hey, everyone. Lord, that is a big ride. Thanks for the ride of 17. What are you doing, Silent Hill? Energy game. Welcome, Raiders, indeed. Trying to currently figure out how I want to do the freckles on the ears. The anniversary stream, how are you? Oh, happy anniversary! That's so fun. Is your robot yet? Thank you. I'm currently. It's actually a chibi commission for an up and coming YouTuber. The model's super cute, by the way. I'm pretty okay at the moment. Planning on just having a short stream because I'm not feeling too well at the moment. So, just streaming for fun. Gotta go rest up, see you around. See you, Morn. Thank you so much for dropping by. It was nice seeing you. We'll better soon. I should. It's just I've started taking medication because my doctor's been getting at me. And it's kind of kicking my ass half the time, so
investigations into the explanations for the lights have been going on.
Once I get used to it, it should be fine, though. That's rough. Yeah, a little bit. Okay, I don't wanna do fucking ears like this. I really don't understand how I want to do that. Oh, it froze. Okay, I think that looks okay. Okay, that makes sense, I think.
Up there was absolutely no one on the mountain, and the That objectively they were scary and that the things that happened in them were decisively not good, but they never bothered me because whenever he would tell me these things, he would just be excited. He would be so happy to share them. And anytime I'd ask him about them, I'd be like, how can you talk about this? It's such a scary, dark story. Why are you so okay with it? And he would always say, well, I've already heard it. Now I get to tell. Legends.
Ew, me. Ew, this is dumb. I'm gonna refund that though because my throat is killing me. Sorry, love. I'll give you a hug though in return. Yeah, it's a pretty low energy stream today. Just chilling because I'm not feeling too well. Yeah, it's really chilling. Side effects of my new tablets are kicking me in the ass, so I'm tired as piss. But you won't be. Good, I made a Mojis one. Show. Right, here they are. They're cute.
Jim was a very kind-hearted man, and all who spoke to him said that despite his condition, he exuded confidence and kindness to whoever he met. Perhaps it was this kindness that changed the heart of Henry, as not long after purchasing Jim, he gave Jim his freedom. But Jim, having nowhere to live and no family to call his own, decided to stick around with Henry, and the two lived together for several years. That was until one particularly brutal winter, when a low harvest from the season prior left Henry's family nothing to eat. Henry, seeing no other Bears are a dangerous predator. Henry knew this. But if a man can get himself a bear...
I'm gonna put you on my list. A hit list? I fully welcome that. Put me out of my misery. I have a therapy session tomorrow and I'm already so tired, bro.
Walking somewhere in the tree. So Jim grabbed a lantern, said goodbye to Henry's family, and set out.
We drink water for this one. Oh, only. You don't have to spend the 300 to get me to drink water now.
Eventually, Henry.
I was forced to add this.
Over the next couple years, everyone seemed to forget about old Henry and old Jim. That was until in 1854, the fate wise men saw their lanterns walking through the tree line. On top of Wiseman's view. Now, it had been too long for the possibility of these two being alive, and, if anything, this was their restless soul trudging across the gorge. And as a matter of fact, according to fate and those who witnessed it, if you waited on a night for the lights to appear and listened close enough as they worked their way up...
No, the 300 means I only do big. You can save your points to something else.
Now, believe it or not,
I can't even remember half the commands I have, so...
That honor would go to the story. An unnamed Revolutionary War soldier came home to find his family lost in the war. As legend has it, the Revolutionary War...
Thanks for feeding me! Not V. V1. Get good old V. We feed V too much, yep, you fed him so much. Just like a fat little fuck that wins every fight.
Said that Lady Adeline was a joy to be around, and everyone in the town took to her instantly. But her husband was a no-good drunk. He was known for long nights of drinking and a short temper to match. And everyone in the town had a sneaking feeling that one day something bad would happen to Adeline. And sadly, in 1848, it seems those fears came true. One Sunday morning, Adeline didn't come to church, so her friends decided to go look for her at her home. When they got there, all they found was her drunk husband, who said that Adeline had decided to up and leave him in the middle of the night. Now, this doesn't sound like something Adeline would do. Sure, it may.
was suspicious, so the same people who were looking for Adeline
went sus.
The hate and fear that exuded from these lights convinced the men that Adeline's husband had conjured up the devil. So they go to his house with pistols and knives and kick down the door, ready to make him answer for what he's done. But whenever they check the house, it seems he's nowhere to be found. And off in the distance, they saw one of the Brown Mountain lights snaking its way over the hill and back down into the gorge. Over the next several decades, men would disappear from the Linville Gorge area, seemingly at random. Authorities and locals alike searched the gorge for some kind of answer. Until one day, as they were searching at the base of the cliff that is today known as Wiseman's View, they found the headless body of Lady Adeline. Now, she was identified by the dress and locket that she was wearing. And as mentioned, her head was nowhere to be found. It seems that either out of pure hatred or just a drunken rage, Adeline's husband had taken off her head and thrown her over Wiseman's View. But despite not having any eyes, if that light leaving his home the night the men came to find him wasn't a coincidence, it seems Adeline was able to find him just fine. Legend has it that pure man never visited the Linville Gorge.
For a quick break.
It's best to just let her pass. Whether you believe in ghost stories or
not, I'm a little storyteller. Have fun.
Things happen around the Linville Gorge. In the 1980s, a man named James Gennett reported having seen the lights after returning to his hotel on his last night in town. The next day, his car was found in the opposite direction he was said to be traveling, but James wasn't in it. In fact, James was nowhere to be found, and he was never seen again. For some reason, his car sat abandoned in the Linville Gorge. And of course, there's the wildlife of the gorge as well. Not only things like bears and snakes, but stories of people called the river rats, who run through the trees and, if you're lucky, simply scare you away. Now, many people doubt stories of the river rats and think them to be the stuff of urban legends. But the odd piece of clothing or half-eaten food found in the most obscure parts of the gorge's wilderness beg to differ. So regardless if you believe in the spirit of the Brown Mountain Lights or not, the gorge definitely has something that goes bump in the night. Locals know to stay away from it, even if they don't know the ghost stories or legends surrounding the gorge itself. Hunters say that you can never hunt anything up there, because anytime you bring your dogs, the dog will run out, get afraid, and come back, refusing to leave their owner's side. Lumbermen try to cut trees around the gorge, say that it's useless. The ground's sour for some reason. Nothing seems to grow right. Now, if you believe in any of the stories I've told, what's to say that they all can't work together? There's been countless battles across the area of the Linville Gorge, from the Native Americans to the Revolutionary War to the Civil War. Seemingly hundreds, if not thousands, of lives have been lost among those hills. Who's to say that Adeline can't walk by the river while the Patriot runs through the hills and Jim and Henry keep circling each other among the trees? Some of the most popular stories of the Brown Mountain Lights involve the battles I mentioned earlier, from the Civil War all the way back to the Native Wars. It's believed that after these battles were over, the women, whose husbands and sons died in the war, would go out at night with torches and lanterns, looking for the bodies of the men they loved. And that those who found them, slain on the battlefield, were forever cursed to continue to haunt those hills to this day. What's interesting about all the stories that I've said is that they all derive from real-world tragedies. There were people murdered and thrown into the gorge. There were people who died of starvation in the hills. And there were people whose families were lost. helpless to stop. And what all of these stories do is they take these tragedies, these real-world experiences people had, and they make them the stuff of legends. They make it to where their suffering meant something greater, something that still affects us to this day, other than a pointless tragedy. One of the reasons that I love horror and scary stories like this is because it elevates human suffering to something that means something. And whenever I think of these stories, I think about the beauty that lies in all the evil. However, while I do love the scary stories of the Gorge, there's a special place in my heart for the stories that show love rather than fear. One of those stories is that of the Catawba woman and the Cherokee man. Hundreds and hundreds of years ago, before white settlers ever came to the land, the Cherokee people and the Catawba people were at war with each other. Now, during this war, the Linville Gorge was a highly contested spot that both sides fought over constantly. Despite this, however, a Catawba woman fell in love with a Cherokee man. And at night, they would slip down into the Linville Gorge, the middle ground between their two people. And through the night, they would share their intimacy and time together before going back to their tribes the next morning. Now, if either side ever figured out what they were doing, they would want the other one dead. So they had to keep it secret. And night after night, they would meet each other at the river in the gorge. That is until one day, when the Cherokee man told the woman that he would have to go fight in the war. Now, of course, they were devastated by this, but she decided she would make the most of it and make sure he knows that her love carries on. So, she went to the top of what is now Wiseman's View and built herself a small house. And every night, she would go to the window of that house and light a torch. Now, the Cherokee man would be on the other side of the gorge, and she couldn't know if he was able to see it. But every now and then, he would pass through the trees and see that torch on top of Linville Mountain and know that his love lives on. Some nights, he would even sneak up to the hills to get away from the other soldiers and light his own torch, so that even if a little bit, her love could be reciprocated. And she would know that her love was still out there, and he was still alive. Till one night, the torch didn't light back. And as a matter of fact, it never came back. It seems that perhaps he died in some war or of some illness, but the worst part is she could never know, because she was still separated by the war of their people and the river at the bottom of the gorge. However, she had promised him that she would light that torch. So every night, she lit it continuously. She eventually became an old woman, but she never forgot the love she had for that Cherokee man. And as legend has it, even though she's long gone, if you look for the Brown Mountain lights at night, you can see that that love still lives on. See, several young couples will say that the Linville Gorge is a wildly romantic spot. And if you've seen the scenery, you know it's at least a breathtaking one. Perhaps the reason that it still holds such a great love despite all the evil that surrounds it is because of the light of that Catawba woman. Another story, and I think the best one to end on, comes from the 1930s. In the nearby area of Jonas Ridge, there was a man who, for all intents and purposes, was similar to the husband of Adeline. He was a hateful drunk who was no good for anyone, especially his young wife, Belinda. After Belinda gave birth to their child, he got drunk one night and simply decided that it wasn't his. And in a fit of rage, depending on who you ask, he either killed them, dumped their body into the gorge, or chased them into the gorge, and nature did what nature does. Over the next several days, search crews began to look for Belinda and her child. However, it seems they couldn't find a trace of either of them.